Welcome to Invention Stories on YouTube, and today we are interviewing Bessie Lee Capel. This episode was originally shared on the Invention Stories podcast, October 9th, 2021. Please be sure to subscribe, comment, and like. Now let's roll.
To be a part of the 7% of all solo inventors in the U.S. as a female means that I am truly a diamond in the rough. I always tell myself that I am a diamond in the rough, but to see the statistics about women inventors in the U.S., solidifies my opinion. Being a female inventor is special, unique, and an amazing accomplishment. I am proud to be amongst the 7%ers.
Welcome to the Invention Stories podcast. I'm your host, Robert Baer, and thank you for joining us. You're listening to our interview with Bessie Lee Capel, owner and founder of the Baby Bottle Brush Bib Company. She designs products that help moms. Now, the intro that you've just been listening to has Bessie sharing her response in our second book, Women Inventors and the 7%. Bessie Lee Capel has invented the brush bib, a protective silicone base that goes around the bottle brushes to prevent backsplash. We have Bessie Lee Capel on the line from the City of Brotherly Love, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. So let's get started. Welcome to the podcast, Bessie. It's great to have you with us today.
I'd like to start off in the beginning. I see that you have three brothers and three sisters. Are you the one in the middle? You're number four?
Smack dab. Yes. All right.
What's it like being the fourth child out of seven?
It's different. It's nice because you have like the best of both worlds. You know, you have your older siblings, you have your younger siblings. And it's just really strange how we're made up where I do have two older sisters and one older brother. And then I have two younger sisters and one younger brother. It's just really crazy how the genders are on both sides to be the middle child. So yeah, I mean, it feels great. I mean, it's nothing really too extraordinary, but it's definitely great to have a large family.
Did you always want to be an inventor? Were you somebody young who just wanted to make some money, or what kind of kid were you?
No, actually, I was not that type of child that, you know, thought about money or thought about being an inventor or entrepreneur. I mean, growing up, you're taught to go to school, get good grades, go off to college and get a great job to be able to sustain a good life for you and your family. And that's the path that I went on. I was always a problem solver since I was young. Always told I had an old soul. I would listen to a lot of people and their stories or their concerns or issues and always gave advice. I was always the friend of giving advice. So it wasn't shocking when I told people I wanted to be a social worker. So that's the route that I took. But the entrepreneur journey just found me. It was something that I seen a need for as a parent. And then I went on from there to create a solution for myself. And that's how it all began.
I read that you were the first one to graduate high school in your family. And now you have a master's degree. How proud must your parents or your brothers and sisters are? You got a master's from Temple University and you live in Philadelphia, right?
So, yes. So, I am definitely a Philadelphia native, born and raised, and still reside in Philadelphia. But I definitely am the first out of my siblings to graduate high school and to pursue a higher education. And yes, I went to Temple for my undergrad degree in social work as well as my graduate degree. And then I also went on to pursue my license in social work. So I am a licensed social worker and I work for the City of Philadelphia.
I saw that. You shared a post where you're sharing your 10th anniversary. And I noticed it had like 180 comments, which is extraordinarily high. So how did you get so many comments? Did that shock you as well? Or is it just everybody knows you and wants to wish you well or what?
Yes. So I do have a wide range of supporters. And yeah, I wasn't surprised with the comments or the likes. Majority of those likes came from my coworkers. I mean, there's thousands of us that's inside of this building doing social services. So it was a good amount of them just saying congratulations. They remember when I first started. A lot of them have been there for 20, 30 plus years. So they were just kind of commending me, saying, job well done, you made it. Now I'm considered what's called vested. So if I wanted to retire, even at the age of 33, I could, and I would definitely have a retirement fund waiting for me. So that's why they were like, congrats, you did it. Like, this is definitely a tough job, but you did it. 10 years, congratulations.
And what's the name of your company?
The baby company you're referring to? Yes.
Do you have multiple?
So, I do. I did have two baby product companies, but the main one, which is the original company I started off with, is the Baby Bottle Brush Fit Company.
Where'd you come up with the name?
So the name actually was inspired by my first product, the Brush Bib. And actually, I shortened the name Brush Bib because originally the actual product itself was called the Baby Bottle Brush Bib. And then that everybody was like, okay, I want to order the, wait, what is it again? So then I wound up just saying Brush Bib. And then as I started creating more products for my company, I said, well, what am I going to call this company? And then a friend of mine says, finish how you started out. You was originally using Baby Bottle Brush Bib for the product. Just use it for the company name and then continue to add your products underneath that. I said, that's smart. Since I already shortened the product name itself to Brush Bib, then my company would just be the Baby Bottle Brush Bib Co. And that would for sure stick out as sore thumb because it's such a long name and it's such a tongue twister.
All right. So you said the first product that you invented was the
brush bib.
And what gave you the idea for the brush bib?
So as you continue to have more than one child, your life becomes more hectic and you are running short on time, short on everything. You know, what you used to have time to do for child number one, you may not have as much time to do for that child and vice versa. So now I'm on child number three and my time is now really running thin. And I'm returning back to work and I'm pumping and all type of stuff. And my youngest child, which is my third child, he was not a breastfed baby at all because he was ill when he was born. He was in the intensive care unit, also known as the NICU out here. So he immediately took to pacifiers and he was on a feeding tube for some time until he graduated to being bottle fed. So since he was used to the bottle and pacifier, he didn't want the breast. So with this is new to me. My first two children, I breastfed them. I didn't have to worry about bottles for a very long time. So now having to wash multiple bottles with my third child became more of a task. And now I'm at work and I'm washing bottles, and I'm pumping and everything like that. And I'm getting water splatters, things all over my clothes from the brush. And I'm like, okay, how do I stop this? How do I prevent it? So I turned to the market and I seen they had brushes that said reduce splashback. I bought those brushes. They were a higher quality brush, better bristles, but the bigger splashback was. So I said, okay, there has to be a barrier. There wasn't a barrier. I started creating my own barrier, trying different things. But then eventually I came across an idea that worked for me. And that's what birthed the brush bit.
Did you create the prototype then yourself?
Yes.
How'd you create it?
Trial and error, a lot of prototypes. I actually first started with my son's baby bibs. I would tie it around and make like a little circular barrier and it kind of worked, but then his bibs were cloth made and it would just harbor a lot of water and start smelling and getting really nasty. So I decided to get a yoga mat and create a barrier, make the same circular barrier, but that was too thick, too bulky. And then just the diameter was ripping. It was just the worst material, but it gave me an idea, a better idea of what I was looking for. But then after that, I started searching the market for other materials that could possibly make do. And I came across a material when I first started selling that was working really well, but I knew I needed something with more elasticity in it so that it could stretch more. And then I ran to a guy who gave me a manufacturer that did silicone, and that's how we wound up kind of perfecting the brush bib. So they're silicone made as of today.
All right. And where are they manufactured?
In China, overseas.
How many do you have to buy at once?
So when I first started out, I had about 10,000 units, and we sold two in each pack. So we have a total of 5,000 packs. So that's how many I had to order. And I was like, okay, where am I going to put all this? How am I going to sell all this? I do not know anything about marketing. I'm new to this. So yeah, it was a lot.
And how long from the time you order till the time it gets to your place of business or your home or wherever you...
So it's a long process. You have to deal with mass production. And then you also have to deal with sea shipping. So when you talk about that, you're looking at about a good maybe 4 to 8 weeks. Definitely 4 weeks minimum, okay? But definitely 8 weeks tops. If you're getting great delivery service, sometimes things get held up, especially with the pandemic. Time frames were actually pushed. So yeah, but it typically, that's what I'm looking at when I order overseas, 4 to 8 weeks. But if I'm doing a new production of a product that we haven't invented before, 4 weeks is not going to stand. You're looking at definitely 8 weeks.
Are there tariffs or different prices that they charge over time? Or has it always been consistent that they've sold you the same amount and it's costed the same amount? Because I've talked to some folks who've been doing it a while, and they're like, well, once the tariffs went in, all of a sudden I had to pay 15% more, and then all of a sudden the shipping cost went another $5,000. Has it been consistent, or has it changed, or have you done multiple orders?
For me, it's been consistent. I haven't had any price changes thus far. I have an awesome manufacturer, and she's always working with me. So at this time, I don't have those issues. And if anything changes price-wise, she will give me a heads up, like, listen, this is what it's going to cost. And actually, my manufacturer is so, like, the best, to the point that she sometimes will, like, fit the cost for me for certain things. Like, she was a cost I don't expect or anticipate, like, oh, we have to pay extra for, you know, this type of packaging. It's the extra 50 cents per whatever. And I'm like, well, we didn't discuss that. And she's like, okay, don't worry about it. I'll just fit the cost. So I have that type of relationship with my manufacturer. So that's awesome to have that type of friendship with your manufacturer.
The brush bib, what color is it?
So we have them in different colors. They come in blue, green, pink, and yellow. What's the best seller? Well, it depends, because typically, if the customer is having a boy, they order the blue and green set. And the girl, they usually do the pink and yellow. So it's hard to tell, because it depends on what they're having. Now, we also have a combination where it's green and yellow for those who are doing gender reveals, or they don't want to say the gender at all. So we have those as well as the option. I can tell you what is the least selling, which is our pink and blue pack. We have it for those who have twins, you know, that may be a boy and girl, fraternal twins. We do not sell often the pink and blue combinations, but definitely blue and green, pink and yellow, and green and yellow are definitely the top sellers.
And you hired out somebody to create your website, is that correct?
Originally, I created my first website and it was trash. So I did wind up sourcing out to a website designer. And like, hey, listen, help me out. I'm actually starting to get more customers. I need to, you know, and I've been getting a lot of professionals that say, listen, you know, you have a great product, but your website sucks. So yeah, I had to hire someone.
Are you selling them on Amazon?
Not everything. Our brush bibs are on Amazon, and that is it. The other products, we try to get them on there, but I am not great with figuring out Amazon yet. I'm still learning. I'm still taking a few of their online courses, so I'm trying to figure that out.
Do you sell more off of Amazon for your brush bibs, or do you sell more off of your website?
I sell more off of my website directly. I know with Amazon, it takes a lot of creating campaigns and ads and stuff like that. So once again, once I continue to familiarize myself with Amazon and how things work and how to create a really good ad, then hopefully we'll pick up on the Amazon sales. Amazon is not as straightforward as everyone may think. I mean, it's straightforward when you're shopping, but not from the sellers end, from my opinion.
Absolutely. There's Amazon experts that are in high demand and worth their weight in gold. How do you promote? Do you use social media?
Yes, definitely. Social media is my best friend when it comes to marketing and promoting. I use Facebook. I have multiple Facebook pages. And that's the best thing about Facebook, is that you can have so many pages. So I market on Facebook. I market on LinkedIn. I also use Instagram. I'm not on Twitter. I have to get that back up running. But those are the main platforms that I'm using at this time.
What's a good use of your time? What do you find has been really productive? And what do you think, like, boy, I wish I didn't do this because this was like totally a waste. Either or.
So what I find a good use of my time is interacting with potential customers on social media. And when I say interacting with potential customers, I actually find groups of individuals on social media, like expected parents or parents with young children, and I try to interact with them on social media. So, for example, on Facebook, there's Facebook groups. I join a lot of different groups on there. So I join Black mom groups or mothers, first-time mom groups and stuff like that. And I interact with these parents, these ones that are asking questions like, oh, my child has eczema, what should I do? And I chime in and I give my advice. And then I also request them to join my page as a friend. So then they can see what I'm doing. And then sometimes that's how they end up in my messenger, wanting to learn more about the product and more about what I'm doing. And then I'll just give them more information. And then that's how I have another customer. And that's also a way of building word of mouth. So that's where I find a great use of my time being spent, just socializing with these individuals on social media. And same thing on Instagram. You know, I see a lot of mom, I'm in a lot of mommy hashtag. And I just go to their pages. I like all their baby pages. I'll say, you know, your baby is so cute. If I see a baby with pacifiers, anything like that, I'll comment because that's part of also what I have on my brand. But every mom, for the most part, wash bottles. And I know that there's some other clever ways to wash bottles, but nothing cleans a bottle, in my opinion, better than scrubbing it old-fashioned away with the brush to get that film at the bottom. So I'm commenting, and then they join my page. And yeah, so that's where a lot of my energy is exhausted to daily.
All right, Bessie, you're working a full-time job with your social work, which you're a wife and a mother of three, and you're trying to grow your business. Do you have a plan for how you manage your time? Is it a structured plan, or do you just sort of put out fires and whatever feels that you want to do that day? What's your approach to time management?
So it's tricky, to be honest with you. The great thing about everything right now is that I am still working mostly virtually for my full-time job as a social worker. We have days that we go into the office, but that's only a couple days a week. And then the other days we're working virtually, i.e. today. So that leaves time for me to also be able to incorporate business time, you know, social media time. The good thing about social media, it doesn't take long to get on, do a quick post and to market it real quick, to respond to some questions or emails, to look up some information for the business, possible upcoming pitch competitions or grants or whatever else that I need to do via my phone or my computer, my laptop. It's easier for me to be home and package orders and then also go back on my work computer and answer those emails and do what I have to do. So it is kind of like all jumbled as far as the work is concerned. And then for the most part, the kids are back in school full time. So that lends me that entire school day to just focus on work. And then once the kids come home, my daughter, my oldest, she's about to be 13. So she really don't care about mommy time or anybody time. She's like teenage time. She's in her room with her girlfriends on the phone, FaceTime, and she don't really care what I do. And then I have the boys. My youngest, he's in daycare. He's usually there until about 5, 6 o'clock. And then I have my middle child, and he is into, what is that game on a computer? Like Roblox or something like that. So with that being said, he doesn't care about me either. So it's not really difficult, but we do have family time every weekend. Every Saturday, Sunday, we watch movies, we watch shows together, we cook, stuff like that. I always make sure I make time for my children. And when they need me or they call me and they need me to give them a signature or something for school, you know, of course, I'm reading over the work. I'll take that time. I'll push everything to the side and make sure I handle what they need for their schooling and everything. My husband, on the other hand, he understands the business. He understands that I have a lot going on and he works himself. So typically, our time is just at nighttime. Once the kids are all down for bed, I try to keep my phone off. Not off, but like I try to keep it away. But I can't resist sometimes the vibrating. So sometimes I'm peeking and checking to see who's texting me or emailing me or whatnot. while I'm still trying to watch a movie with my husband. So that kind of like ticks him off from time to time. But we try to have nighttime for ourselves. So I try. You can't make everybody happy, you know, but you try your best. That's all you can do.
What products, what else can be found on your website? What else are you selling?
So the other items you can find on babybottlebrushclip.com is our all-in-one pacifier teether clip. And it's the only all-in-one pacifier teether clip that's out there in the market because it doubles as a teether. It grows a baby from infancy to toddlerhood, has changeable suspender clips, FDA-approved, BPA-free. And it's just better for the baby's oral health. And then we also have our elephant suspender clips, which is just the attachment that goes on the baby's clothes. We made that double as a teether in silicone as well, so that you no longer have to deal with the suspender clips on their pacifier clips anymore. So those are the additional items that you will find on babybottlebrushclip.com.
What have you enjoyed most about your business and starting this and being an inventor and being an entrepreneur? What have you enjoyed most about it?
It just makes me really happy, to be honest with you. I mean, social work makes me happy. It's very fulfilling. But this is a different level for me, a different level of happiness. And seeing my customers contact me and say, wow, like this really works. Like this brush fit really works. Or I need to order two more. Or I need to order three more. I have another baby shower coming up. Just having my customers come back to me for the item, for the brush fit, for the barrier. It solidifies for me that this is definitely an item that globally can be very beneficial. So it's heartwarming. It's beautiful. I love it. And this is why I will continue to invent.
Well, I want to thank you for being our guest today on the Invention Stories podcast, Bessie. But before I let you go, I'd like to ask you one final question. And that is,
so somebody who's very new to inventing in general comes up to you and asks for your advice, what advice would you give them?
So what I will say is definitely try your best to do as much research as possible. Research the process. Watch YouTube videos. Read all of Robert Bear's books. This is the biggest. No, but honestly, your books are definitely one of the biggest insights to invention, inventors, and how we go about the processes and the trials and tribulations and how we get through them and the beginnings and just everything. So really, you're helping all individuals out there who have these questions about the process and how inventors do what they do. So definitely they need to pick up Robert Bear book.